Time to continue this series of El Nino updates. Matt Makens here. Thanks for watching that last video. And the last one was a while back, and it showed you kind of the perspective of some of the strong El Ninos and why some of them are so different. Let's get more specific this time. We're closer to winter. We're getting more data. So what have winters with El Nino done in terms of snowfall? You're looking at a series of maps, 82, 83, 87, 88. Here's snowfall from 91 to 92. Snowfall in the 90s from 97 to 98. Let's get into 02 and 03, 09 and 10, 15 and 16. If those El Nino years sound familiar, they should. They're some of the stronger ones. What did that mean in the end? Well, a lot of folks didn't have the snowfall they thought they would see around the Pacific Northwest across the northern states, but it was snowier than normal for Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, out toward the mid-Atlantic states. That's just a general look at some of the El Ninos of the past. What is this one going to be like? What is the latest as this El Nino develops? Here again, we're looking at the sea surface temperatures. Satellites measure these. You can get some buoy data. You get ship data, all kinds of stuff. Compose those maps. This one's based on satellites, and I drew the black boxes here. That is the area where we look for El Nino. And again, there are four regions. I only draw three on the map. There's another one right in here. It's called the 3.4. That's classically where you're going to see the forecast for El Nino coming from, although there's a lot more to it. That's just looking at ocean conditions, not the atmosphere, and you have to do that too. But for the sake of argument, let's look right in this region, the 3.4 region. What has it been doing recently? But as you go back in history for that region, in August, 1.3 degrees Celsius was the average temperature of that particular box, that particular region. How does that stack up historically? That's going to be the fourth warmest August on record, and again, going back since 1953. These chiclet maps, I prefer them, you may not. So let's break it down a little more classically, if you will. This chart has all of our El Ninos on it since 1980, and then this deeper red line, that's the current year. Where does it rank? Well, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we're fourth strongest at this point. And what's the trajectory looking like? Well, obviously upwards, going to head toward that 2 degrees Celsius mark. That's above average in Celsius. But it's going to trend similar to some of these past years that we have. It's already well ahead of average, obviously. But what may it be like? And that becomes critical. Why do we care about the strength of El Nino? I mean, El Nino is El Nino, right? Absolutely not. In that last video, I broke it down for you. If you thought for a second and you looked at those images, you know that no two El Ninos are identical. So why does it matter? Why do we care about the strength? El Nino is not just El Nino. It breaks it down by strength and impact. So here's weak El Ninos temperatures, and here are the temperatures for strong El Ninos. Do you see a big difference? Obviously you do. For Alaska, it's going to be pretty warm during El Nino events. But look at parts of Canada. You get a weaker event and your temperatures somewhat lean cooler for central and eastern Canada versus a super strong El Nino, in which case you have much hotter temperatures. The same for the northern U.S., northern states into the Great Lakes. A lot of heat comes with the strongest El Ninos. In weaker ones, it's a little bit more hit and miss. As far as the southern states, from California into Texas, yeah, it's still cool in both cases, but the magnitude of that is different. And for the southeast, say you're around Georgia or Florida, your temperature pattern is much different from weak El Ninos to very strong ones. What about in terms of precip? Big differences there too. Weak El Ninos, very strong ones. In stronger events, you're able to spread a lot more water across the country versus weaker events. Pacific Northwest would favor from a super strong El Nino. With weaker ones, you tend to be a bit drier. Alaska, coastal areas get a lot more water in super strong El Nino events. And throughout Canada, big differences from one pattern to the other, especially for British Columbia, Alberta, and the Canadian Rockies. So knowing that strength does matter, what's the forecast looking like? If you look at all models plotted together and different agencies, different countries obviously have different computer models, they're all assembled here. Bottom line here, this deep kind of maroon color, brick color, that's the average of some of those models. And that takes us up to about 2 degrees Celsius, warmer than average, in that same ENSO region, the 3.4 region. Very similar to the trajectory I showed you just a few minutes ago in that chart. So what do temperatures do in some of these most similar years? Well, they're very warm from Alaska into British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan. So a lot of the Canadian prairies, very warm in these setups. Northern states, Montana and North Dakota, come away as some of the warmest locations. But we have warmth across the Pacific Northwest, Northern Plains, Great Lakes, into New England. That's with similar years. The cold weather kind of sits down across the South, from Mexico into the southern states. That's what kind of happens in general over the most similar years. Here's our precip layout. Very dry BC into Alberta, the Canadian prairies dry. The Great Lakes region into the mid-Atlantic, very, very dry versus the average. And we get the water from coast to coast along the southern half, if you will, of the country. And we can extend that into the prairies of Colorado, the plains there, into far southeastern Wyoming, Nebraska, Kansas, Missouri will catch some of that water too, but primarily it focuses on the southern tier of the states to get some water during most similar years. What about snowfall? I'm a snow lover. I know a lot of you are who have subscribed to my page are snow lovers too. If you look at history, this would be kind of the average snowfall for winter. And again, it's assuming a 10 to 1 inch ratio. So in some cases, like the mountains, you're going to get higher totals than that. But what does this mean? It's kind of hard to grasp. Okay, well, maybe that's the most similar snowfall totals we've had, but what does that do on average? So on average, when you bring in an El Nino like what we're expecting, you reduce snowfall in Alaska, much of Canada, the northern states all reduce the snowfall, cutting it in half in some of those cases. The southern states, however, from the Four Corners through New Mexico, Panhandles, out into the southeast, you can increase your frequency and snowfall totals. Zoom that map in. If we're across the country and you're a snow lover, here are some of the totals. Again, that's based on a long period of record and looking at some of the most similar El Ninos. And departures, you're looking here. Green areas, that's if you're a snow lover, you're going to see more snow in these areas than average and less snow across northern states versus the average based on the current projections of this El Nino we're going through. So there you go. That's El Nino in a nutshell in terms of snow and cold. If you missed that last video, great perspective on the differences within all of these El Ninos and why they're different. Check it out.